Let me start with a little bit about myself. The question, where are you from, is always super difficult for me to answer because in my case, there's never a short answer. About my music, well, I learned Carnatic music as a youngster. I had a wonderful guru, and I moved to Chennai to pursue music as well as psychology about 11 years ago. And following that, I did a brief stint in London where I did my master's at the London School of Economics in organizational behavior. And I came back to Chennai for the second time in 2011 to voluntarily enslave myself in the corporate world. And while it works for a lot of you, no offense, no hard feelings, it didn't work for me. And a year later, I found myself quitting the high-flying corporate world to pursue music as a full-time playback singing professional. It's been 5 years since that bold or naive decision. I get both versions, but there's been no looking back, there's been no regrets, because I feel like I don't think I could ever do anything after doing what I am at present. The concept of merge, past forward, it makes a lot of sense to me as a musician, because there's this constant effort to preserve ancient forms of music, deep-rooted traditions, and ensure that people in the present and the future have access to it, and not only have access to it, but can also relate to it. Just because you have the means to a certain resource doesn't mean you identify with it. So while we make sure that knowledge is transferred, you should also make it relevant. So with this view, my husband and I, we launched Music Gallery Productions. And what we do is that we present traditional art forms such as Carnatic music and Hindustani music, and we change the arrangement a bit and make it sound more contemporary, give it a modern flavor. A lot has to do with how we package music, and this is something I find myself speaking about quite often. Youngsters these days, when you, I'm not generalizing, but quite a few of them don't really enjoy the concept of attending a Carnatic concert, a kacheri, or a Hindustani recital. And they cringe and say, you know, why should I go for a kacheri? I'd rather go to a rock concert. But if you change things up a little, if you throw in some drums, throw in some guitars, and make it sound different, then they lap it up immediately. Again, in the concept of, in the zone of past forward, I'd like to speak about how technology has played a revolutionary role in shaping the recording process. Back in the day, things worked quite differently, and since a lot of you would be curious to know how recordings happen, I'll give you a brief, I'll give you a summary. So all the musicians would be in one room, and this would include, like, say, a 60-piece orchestra, violins, cellos, everything, and the singers as well. And everybody would be required to deliver the entire song in one shot, okay? Now that's like a 5-minute song, which doesn't seem like a lot, but there's a lot of coordination involved. And while this worked really well for the chemistry and the spontaneity and the whole magic, you know, in that room, it may not have been the most convenient way to record, because the smallest error would require a retake, and that's about 100 people in one room, and you can just imagine the levels of frustration. Today, how we approach recordings has been changed completely by technology. You could record your voices in one city. For instance, you could record your voices in Coimbatore. You could record your drums in Delhi. You could do your guitars in another country altogether, say the United Kingdom. A lot of people go to Australia, go to Sydney to record their string sections, and the mixing and mastering is done in the US. So a single song travels throughout the world and then comes back right to you, to your room where you're working on your song. It's quite fascinating. So I'm going to do this song next. It captures what I've been speaking about till now. For one, it is sung in the Hindustani style, and it's got a contemporary flavor. And secondly, the voices were recorded in Chennai, and the music production was done in the US by a close friend of mine, and the song was mixed and mastered in Bombay. And then I'm going to do that song for you today. Can we have track one, please? Thank you. Thank you. This version is also available on YouTube, and I collaborated with a dear friend of mine, Pooja Vaidyanath. It's available on YouTube. So while doing my research for this talk, I had a couple of thoughts that I wanted to share with you. And like Anusha mentioned earlier, certain issues that we encountered in the past are going to continue into the present and the future. For instance, one of the most distinguished poets India has seen, Mahakavi Subramanya Bharati, also referred to as Bharatiyar. He wrote some soul-stirring poetry so many years ago, covering issues like patriotism, feminism, against the caste system, and against female oppression. He encouraged women to be a lot more participative and rejected all norms that would ostracize them. Coming back to the present, we are still dealing with issues of gender inequality and inadequate representation of the sexes. My point being that certain struggles, certain battles that have been fought so many years ago are still relevant today. And though he wrote these pieces, these poems so many years ago, they're still relevant today, implying that it is really up to us to decide the course of these struggles, and it is up to us as to what method we adopt to rectify them. I'm going to be wrapping up this segment by presenting one of his most beautiful pieces. This was also used for a movie and set a tune by Rehman sir. I'm going to be presenting a poem by Bharatiyar.